I am Marla Cohen. I am a chef. Call me Marla. Don't call me chef. And welcome. How cool is this day? Is this not an incredible day? And I was just telling some of the ladies that were here first, it's always my luck to be with 1,000 women and there's like 4 guys and they're all married. It's always my luck. 53 and single, and still I can't get booked at like an Eagles convention or a Elks or, you know, a Freemason. They're free, they don't even cost anything, and I can't get one. So I don't know what it is. What we're gonna do today is, I have a spice with kind of a bad name, and it's called super shit, and it's actually shitterine, is a Yiddish term I grew up with. I didn't know it was a bad word until I got old enough to know it was a bad word. If your grandma was a shit cook, you were like coveted. Other kids loved you. And what that means is, shitterine means to throw it in a pot with uncanny intuition and skill, but no recipe. So many people freak out, they need a recipe. How many times have you gone in a restaurant and seen the cooks on the line cooking your food holding a cookbook? Once you learn a method, it's very simple to cook. So what we're gonna learn today is an old school method back from French cooking back in the 30s that is now gonna be a method that you're gonna employ in your house when you're in a hurry and don't know what to do. And that method is called poêlé. Poêlé is kind of a combination. Does anyone know what sauté means? Yes. What does sauté mean? It
means to fry like.
Nope, but that's close. Sauté actually literally translates in to jump. And that means you jump it in the pan. It's short, quick, intense heat jumping. And there's another method called pan frying. And a lot of the Asian culture, they don't even have an oven in their house. They only have a stove, and so, or a stove top or fire to cook, so everything's done on top of the stove. Therefore, they're cooking rapidly with intense heat, but it's not getting in an oven. And that's what we've named in bigger quantities, stir fry. It's so much in there, they can't shake it and make it jump in the pan, so they stir it to cook it. But it's that intense top of the stove cooking. So there's this French method, and I want you to think for a minute. I'm a cook who thinks, and if you think you really know the answer, I'm going to tell you that you know it. When you make coffee, do you eat the coffee grounds? No, you've extracted the flavor, and you throw out the grounds. When you cook something, back in the olden days, and you'd have that can of Crisco or whatever brand you used, and you cooked 5 or 6 or 10 times with it, did it get lighter and smell better? Got darker. Why? And didn't it start smelling like the food that was cooked in it? Because it extracts flavor. So you have this incredible exterior on the outside of your food, and those natural sugars or carbohydrates in it have been caramelized, so your first bite of whatever you're eating is so good because it's been fried, and then everything else follows suit because you have that crusty outside caramelization on the tip of your tongue. And everything that follows it is you're thinking it tastes just like that outside because that's what you're tasting in your mouth. Your tongue has a memory. Stuff stays in your mouth for a while residually. So what we don't realize when we cook, when we boil, we extract. So if you really think about it, cook carrots. What happens to the water? Carrot water. Right. It gets orange and it actually smells and tastes a little like carrots. So if you use that to its advantage to make a soup or something where the goal is to extract vanilla, coffee, tea, you're extracting flavor. But in most cooking, you don't want to extract flavor. You want to add it or you want to retain it. The problem is that we've become lazy as a population and we want everything done for us. We want to pick up the beef roast and it's seasoned. We want to pick up something and it's seasoned and everything's already in it and we simply apply heat. The problem with that is everything that's in it. That's the problem. So I'm going to teach you this old school method. You'll have it in your head for the rest of your life. And when you go to cook, you'll notice that anything that we do extract stays in. I don't pour it down the drain. I don't put it in the Crisco can with the oil. All the flavor stays in the pan until it goes into you. Nothing's extracted. We're going to use everything. So I'm going to show you that method. The first thing that I'm going to do is preheat my pan, because a cold pan, remember the movie where the kid wants to get the PB gun or whatever, it's a Christmas movie, and he licks the cold pole, and what happens? Okay, I want you to have that vision where he sticks to cold. Food sticks to cold. Now think about hot. When you touch a hot stove, do you pull away or do you go back in for more? You pull away. It's like, ah. So your body already instinctively knows that heat repels. So if you start with a hot pan, stuff won't stick because what you put in is going to be repelled. It's not going to go and stick. So we're going to start with a hot pan. The next thing is, Megan, will you stand up? If we go in the oven at the same time, who's done first? Everybody's laughing. Nobody's answering. Come on, ladies. You're smart. She's done first. Right. So when you have something as simple as a chicken breast, there's half an end that's thin, and then it gets to the bulbous part, the breast. There's another Yiddish term I'll teach you called zaftig. Zaftig means plump. So the zaftig part of the chicken breast, you don't want it to be raw. So in order to cook, whoop, hang on one sec. I don't want to have smoke in here, or we'll have the crazy people. We're going to cover this for a second. I talk too much. I'm not ready to toss it in yet. So when you have the zaftig side, in order to get the thick part of the chicken cooked, oh my gosh, you overcook the thin part. So here's where you're going to hope for that residual, the flavor hanging out on your tongue, that tough half of the chicken that's all dry, that you remember that when you're eating the moist part, and then residually, maybe that flavor carries through. Now, I'm going to teach you how every bite can be incredible. I'm going to make me into Megan. And you know how I know? Here's how I'm going to do it. How tall are you? 5'9". Oh, you're 5'9", I'm 5'9". Okay, but here's the deal. When I got on the scale at the grocery, they have that big scale, not here, in the Midwest, because we weigh ourselves in the Midwest. Out here we don't, or there'd be so many suicides on the road. We're Southern California, we got to let that happen. So in the Midwest, we weigh ourselves. Sometimes you guys here, I notice you weigh your food, like you get a salad and they weigh it and you pay by the ounce. We weigh our people because in Indiana, we don't just eat what we take out, we eat while we're there. Like, oh, those look good, let me try those. No, I don't want those. And it's not just a grocery store, it's a grazing station. You've not been to the Midwest? Come on. Okay, so I know when I got on that scale and I looked and it said, like large frame, medium frame, whatever. You know how tall I am? Because I figured I'm medium frame. In order to be normal weight and medium frame, I'm 7'4". Yes, I'm 7'4", then I'm medium frame. So I'm gonna make this chicken, which now is 5'9", I'm gonna make it 7'4", so it cooks more like Megan. It's in a Ziploc bag, and I leave a little bit of air, but not a lot. And then I take a pan and I just hit it. And we're gonna move this because they're gonna fall. We'll come back to heat that, I promise you. And we're gonna move this because you'll have to hear it bounce. The good part is you can't hear my thighs bouncing. They bounce. Okay, and we're just gonna use the back of the pan. And I don't spend money on a meat mallet. And I'm just hitting the fat part. Can you see the difference between the one that's pounded and the two that aren't? At 3 o'clock, we'll tell you how to buy chicken. Right now, you're just learning how to cook it. And just like my jeans, a little explosion out the back. I know, they always have it in the front, like so your belly can explode. People look at your face. I'm gonna design the pant where when you're really full, that still stays closed and controlled, and the one in the back opens up and you just spill out. It's gonna be, you talk about like the skinny girl who created all this stuff, I'm gonna start a line called Fat Girl Clothes, and it's gonna be based on what I've always wanted, not skinny girl. Okay, so now we have the same thickness of all our chicken. So we probably need that stove again, huh? The fire marshal guy came in. I had to get like top secret approval to do this. So here's the Poêle method. You have on you, every one of you, has a meat thermometer. Did you know that? I'm left-handed, so that is going to be my steak. My left hand is my steak. My right hand is more sensitive because I don't use it all the time when I'm writing. My right hand is my thermometer. With the fat part of my palm on my steak hand, the hand I write with, I close my eyes, and with my middle finger, the one next to the ring finger that doesn't have a ring because nobody asked yet, that one? Okay, the middle one. That's the one that reminds you that the next one's lonely. Anyway, I'm going to feel this. That's what rare feels like. If I touch this chicken and I push hard, that's what it feels like. If I put these two fingers together, close my eyes and hang it down and feel it, that's exactly what medium protein feels like. Fish, chicken, beef, a big roast, a little steak. When you push that, that's what it feels like. And a tight fist, and I feel it, that's exactly what well done feels like. I touch it, well done. Okay, I guess we'll just go in the exit wound there. We're going to put a little flour, unseasoned. Why unseasoned? Somebody shout out. Why? No, but that's a good guess. In the flour? That's part of it. Here's the other reason. Can I control it? How much is going on the chicken? And are you going to save that flour after you put raw chicken in it? I'm going to throw it out. So I want you all, in fact, I take it back. Put the seasoning in the flour. Buy my seasoning. Put it in the flour. Throw it out again and again and again and buy more and more and more. I don't know why I said that. What was I thinking? Okay, a little bit of olive oil. Now, this is flour. It can be nuts. It can be oatmeal. You can coat it in granola. It does not have to be flour. I'm doing flour because I'm lazy, and it was easy and quick today to teach you the method. It can be anything that you want it to be that you coat it in. No eggs, no nothing, because we're not frying. We're going to puelle. So what puelle is it's the concept that to break down structure, and you guys all know this because you've done this. You cook a steak, it's from, or a piece of chicken or something, and you cook it quickly, there's a point at which it's tender, and then you've overcooked it. So what do? You cook it more, and then it retenderizes. If you think about it, if you take meat, stew meat, and you cook it, it breaks down with cooking and cooking and cooking and cooking and cooking. It breaks down. So we're going to do that, but we're going to do it in a quick, intense heat method. So we have the chicken, and we're going to cook the chicken, and all I'm going to do is move it around a little. I am absolutely not going to turn it until I see that it's halfway cooked. And I'll see that because naturally proteins coagulate, change color. Why don't I turn it and turn it 15 times? Why do I only turn once in this method? Okay? Partly, and I'm going to tell you the reason. How many of you ever laid out on the beach? Got tan. Those of you now that don't and are vitamin D deficient, I'm okay with that, or vitamin A deficient, I guess. Here's the deal. When you turn it, and you turn it, and you turn it, you recook the same thing again and again and again, and you still don't get to the center. Think about it. You're at the beach, you lay down, you get tan. Then all of a sudden you turn over, you get tan. How come your stomach and your lungs don't cook? Because you keep turning. Well, think about it. You see roadkill on the side of the road. Those lungs, they're toasty. But you aren't because you keep turning. I don't want to rotisserie this chicken. I want to cook it. So we're going to take this, and now that we have it, we're going to add a few quick apples to it. I have a couple different kinds of apples here, and I don't know if you know, there's a recall right now on apples. These are not those. Or maybe I missed the email. Maybe it is those. Sorry, guys. You're eating it. I'm not. And I'm going to throw these in and look for the natural caramelization. I'm going to put a little water. There goes the fire alarm. Here comes the guy. Like you said, there wasn't going to be smoke. You'll learn one thing. I am 53 and single, and I lie. If I said, yes, there's going to be a ton of smoke, these people would be so disappointed when they came here and we did this all raw. I had to lie to you. I'm sorry. And rest assured, Andy, you're not the first man I've lied to. I lied to the one at the license bureau. I'll tell you one time I didn't lie. Anybody ever gone on the helicopter thing in Vegas down into the Grand Canyon? Well, we were going to Rita Rudner the night before. She's a comedian. You know who Rita Rudner is? So we go to hear Rita Rudner, and she starts talking about this helicopter trip for which I'm booked the next day. You go down in, you go on sacred Indian land. It's like Indian area where it's not even the federal people can't go there, federal parks. You go down and you have this great lunch with a little glass of champagne and a plastic bottle and a cold turkey croissant, and it's like, you know, $40,000. So she's telling the story, and she said, oh, when she found out they weighed you, she told the people she was with, lie by 20 pounds. And I thought, 20? They weigh you? Because they have to sit you in the helicopter a certain way? So I went with my business partner, Lynn, her son, Sean, and I said, Sean, lie by 70 pounds. Because that's what I'm lying by. So we get in. Now, it's all paid for. This was my aunt's big gift for my big whatever birthday it was. And we get there, and they make you step on the scale. And the guy can read it. And I said, just a minute. I just drank some water. I just did this. So this guy knows where I am. And then they tell you exactly where on the helicopter you have to sit. It's really, yeah, it's not such a good thing. So I tried to lie to him, but he knew I might lie. What? No, I lived. I lived, and here I am. Okay, so now I have in here apples. Look at the beautiful color on that chicken. Just flour, a touch of olive oil. The back is still naked. Whoop. And now you guys are going to love this. Raise your hand back row so I can see you back there. Okay, I know I'm not going to have 200 samples, whatever. We're going to cut everything up and let you guys try and taste it. But I always start in the back row first because you always feel like you got the bad seat, so I will start with the snacks back there. I know it because one of my friends when I was a kid, her last name started with Z, and mine started with C, and she was like the last at everything. All right, so now we're going to add just a little bit of real live maple syrup. And then here's what makes it Puelle. I need this, and I'm probably going to need more water. Puelle is where we cook it in the pan. You could add stock, water, whatever you want. And what we're going to do is we're going to reduce that water back out by evaporation and going up where it's not supposed to go and setting off sensors. And it's going to tenderize and finish cooking the chicken and make the sauce all at the same time while it cooks. So we're going to let it cook, and we're going to come over here and talk for a minute. We're going to talk quickly about chicken, even though this afternoon we're going to talk about it a little more. When you buy chicken, and when people say things about fresh in America, oh, it's fresh, it's never been frozen. Somebody fixated on frozen being bad. Somebody fixated on that and decided that something being fresh is always better. Here's the deal. Let's say your kid has a dirty diaper. Do you want it in your car? Or would you rather, if you have to do something, would you rather stick it in the freezer? I don't mean your freezer like you're going to eat it. But what stops the decay, the degradation, and the smell, and it decomposing? Freezing it. I'm not a huge fan of frozen stuff, but things that can get bacteria and it manifests and grows, to me, if I'm living in an area like Indiana and I don't see an ocean near me, and I know it's going to go from New York or L.A. to Chicago, Chicago to Indianapolis, Indianapolis to wherever, and then finally my hometown of Fort Wayne. That's a lot of travel time. And the entire time, because it was once a living mammal, if you have beef or veal or chicken, or if it's not a mammal, if it's fish, any of those things go through degradation and decomposition. So the deal with freezing is that we as Americans have not demanded enough from our freezer manufacturers. My brother has four kids. One child was conceived as a surprise. The others, they really struggled to get. And of course, it was the youngest guy. And they went through a process called in vitro. Do you know that the in vitro was all done once? Or I guess when they make the zygotes or whatever. And then they went back a few times and had implanted. They were all from the same batch. Well, how come I can have Mackenzie, who's now 17, and Abby, who's 12, and they're all from the same batch frozen the whole time, but my broccoli in the freezer is crap in 5 days? Shouldn't Abby be all freezer burned and crappy? Because, my gosh, look what happens to ice cream. The reason is because it's kept frozen so much below the temperature at which, I wish I had a second burner. Wouldn't that be cool? Okay, so we're gonna pour out just a little bit of the water here. Oh, look at you, you're so cool. All right, I put a little too much water in when I got nervous about the smoke. Yeah. Pull my scarf this way?
Yeah, it's hitting your mic. And
okay. You want me to just take it off? Play a little music. Da 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 da. No? Okay. They wanted me to move my scarf. I should have heard all that wind. I thought those guys were like getting into a trance and breathing hard. It was me the whole time? Oh, that's not good. All right. We're picking out some apples. It's going to start again because I'm bending down, isn't it? I heard it. Megan, you want to come in? We'll take my scarf off. Sorry, it's not that I'm helpless, but I don't want to pull a wire out. Is that better?
That is good.
Oh, man. And now part of that is like it's the same thing with the zipper in the back. That's the double chin hider. You all focus on like right here and my eyes, and now you're right there. And so thank you there. That's why you have a wife and it's not me. Thank you so much. Later on, I'll take off my shoes and socks. We'll get comfy. I poured some of that out, so I had to put it here. And then we're going to hit it with pecans. Where do we go? We have pecans. Sorry, I'm all stymied now because I'm addressing in front of a man, in front of a room of people, and there's no Poland music. So, yeah. Hey, ladies, you got to give me a break. When I get out of the shower, I pray for fog. I don't even want to see it. It's not, it's bad, I know, I'm sorry. Okay, we're going to put this one over here. I may have to cut it a second and put it back in the little pan because I don't think I got stymied by the minute you told me to undress. Okay, here we go. We're going to put that in, that little bit of pink. All right. Okay. We're going to make another one, and I'm going to go to fish, because some of you are don't eat meat, I guess I understand. So we're going to go to some fish first, and we're going to use a couple quick ingredients with it. This is a little of my super stuff. Super shitterine, and it's not a bad word, those of you that came in after. Shitterine's a legitimate cooking method. Don't give me shitterine about it. And it wasn't a bad word until Americans made it a bad word. It used to be an honor in the Yiddish culture. Shitterein, S-H-I-T, and then the second word is A-R-E-I-N. It looks like R-N, but it's not R-N, it's a rhine. All right, we're going to put this here, and I'm going to cut it, and then if you would put a little bit of the, well, we'll chop that after. I'm going to get another pan going here for the fish. Okay, what's the name of this method? Puele. Yeah, it's like instead of frying, it's water. P-O-E-L-E. Tell you about me? I'm 53 and single, and that's the first thing I'm saying now, because for like 10 years I didn't say it. I'm 43 and single. Because some of you have a brother, a cousin, an uncle. Man, at this point, I'll go visit like his spouse in the cemetery with him and cry if he's on his second one. I'll be like, oh, I'm so sorry. I know she was wonderful. What did she make you? I'll make it. You all laugh. I'm crying. My parents are both deceased, and I joke all the time that my father would be dying if he knew that his two daughters were single and that water costs more than beer. Yeah. Wouldn't that be a funny one? All right. I'm going to mix these up. Somebody may get the nut. Somebody may not. Little technical difficulty here. Okay. The next one we're going to talk about is fish. I'm going to do a quick cod, and it is a line-caught cod. It's not net-caught, and it's wild, and it's a mild fish. And we're going to do a quick method of puelle without any starch. And these are called liquid aminos. Is anybody familiar with liquid aminos? Who's not familiar with liquid aminos? Okay. So what liquid aminos are, do you know what amino acids are? Amino acids, there's 9 essential amino acids for cell structure to regenerate, to build your body. Those are the things you hear of like leucine, lysine, tryptophan, the one at Thanksgiving that makes you tired, all that. These have a ton of amino acids in it, but it isn't a soy-based product. It is gluten-free. And it has probably the sodium content of light soy. But the flavor is incredible, and we're going to use so little. That is now to jump. And the only reason I'm doing that is to show you I can do that. Put that on the resume. Say, and she can make her food jump in a pan, Larry. I'm telling you, call her. Well, his name could be Larry, Harry, Mark. I don't care. I just picked out Larry. I don't know. Okay, so I'm going to set this here, and you guys can spoon that one up. Got it? Okay. Let me get Mr. Chicken out of the way. We're going to go to some quick fish. All right. Actually, I'm going to use the littler pan. And for the fish, we're going to do something really weird. We are going to take a touch of sugar, and it won't taste like sugar when it's done. And we're going to pour it in the pan, and we're going to caramelize it. Sugar is what makes taffy, all those things incredible, because it's pliable. For those of you that don't eat sugar, you're not going to do this. So it's a small amount of sugar, and typically you can do 2 or 3 pieces. We put it in the pan, no fat. We're not going to use any fat in this. But we're going to do the puelle method with liquid aminos and the water. And like I said, you can use vegetable stock or whatever. When it comes to fish, that's something that, unless you're in a big city or you got it frozen, they can fool you. Do you know one of the ways to know when they say that it's fresh or it's frozen, how to test them if they're honest and they have integrity? If you put that fillet in a bowl of ice water, if it sinks to the bottom, it's been frozen. If it floats in the top, it was never frozen. So when it thaws out, just put it in ice water. You'll know immediately. Because the way the cell structure, the water in it, and the ice crystallizes, it like pops, and then they're not buoyant anymore. So you can do that with children, too. You throw them in the water. Sometimes they swim. Sometimes they're not buoyant anymore. So speaking of water, I remember once, anybody here ever been on a cruise? Okay, they say the cruises are for the newlywed, the overfed, and the nearly dead. And, yeah, and my mom wanted to send, at the time, her 2 single daughters on a cruise, a Jewish singles cruise. And I was like, Mom, that's a target. That's like in the Caribbean with a bunch of unbred Jewish couples that have not yet married or met each other even. That is just a floating target. I'm not going on that. Okay, do you see how it's turning liquid? The sugar is turning liquid? Just sugar. It's turning liquid. It'll turn this cool amber, then it'll get dark and almost start to burn, and the guy that's my smoke police will come running. So we're going to wait till it just about starts to burn. It's getting a little smoky. Just sugar in the pan. Probably 1/2 tablespoon, 2 teaspoons. It's getting smoky. It's almost smoky. There's the fire marshal guy here. If he comes in 3rd time, that's like a 3rd date. I got to take him to meet my aunt because my parents are both dead. So he's been here twice. All right, and that's on top of the sugar. No flour, just sugar and the fish. You can do that with any fish you want. You can do this with shrimp. Don't do it with shrimp, but you can. Okay. Oh. I don't know if you can see that caramelization on the outside. Here. Why don't I use shrimp? Because fish was easier today. You can do this method. This is still the Puelle method, but we're caramelizing it first. Hello, this is a selfie. My name's Marla. My parents are dead, so they won't give you any grief. My brother and sister have been warned. And what's your friend's name? I'm getting bold now, I'm telling you. I'm tired with being passive. Passive didn't work. All right, so now same method. We're waiting till it's halfway cooked. We're going to flip it. Oh, do you see it? Just sugar and fish. See it? Do you see how I'm running back and forth? That's exercise and I'm already winded. This is, can you what? You can come here and step up because I don't want to take it off the heater. We'll be here till 11:40. And now, see that fish? Look at that. And now we're going to hit it with a touch of liquid bitters, liquid aminos. Can you buy that in this you can get in any store, health food store. We're going to hit it with a little fresh parsley. We're going to a little bit of green onion. And then I have to, because these are what I make, real, which is for fish and chicken and anything you want to put it on, but especially fish. And that's it. Done. Real. R-E-E-L, like a reel of fish. And if we see it's going to start to burn, we just stop the burn with a touch of water. And Chris, I'm going to just cut this in the pan maybe, or cut it and then put it in the pan. Okay. Let's turn over the chicken. Different knife. You people in back that got the chicken, was that all right? I'm going to go back in to get the sauce. Probably a half a teaspoon. Get all the yum sauce back on all around every piece. Okay, who are my tofus in here? Okay, we're going to do one with tofu real quick. I know, I thought of you too. You know that noise you keep hearing? It isn't interference, it's my heart. Boom, boom, boom. I'm panicking. I see the time. How much time do we have left? As much as we want. That's my rule. We'll just keep going. You guys got to be somewhere, you just get out and leave. All right, here you go. Here's the fish, Chris. And we're going to do tofu. For the tofu, we're going to do kind of an odd one. We're going to do a mango tropical. Now, I'm starting with cubes of tofu that are roasted, so I don't need to cook them. So we're going to just make the sauce. So I'm going to cheat a little, and I'm going to pretend that I am, I'll get you fresh flour instead of the chicken flour. How's that? And here you are, my vegan friends, and I've made it with chicken flour. One more time? With a touch of olive oil, soy, and in the oven. What? No, like 375, but I have a convection oven. Yeah. All right. Tofu's great. It's a chameleon. It'll take on the flavor of anything you put with it. We're going to do a touch of olive oil. So far, olive oil. Oh, when I roasted it, you know, save yourself the trouble. Buy roasted tofu at the health food store. Buy a hunk of roasted tofu, cut it in squares. But I use olive oil and a touch of either soy or liquid aminos. Let me get the non-fish and chicken tongs here. And we'll do more. There's a bunch of you here. We're going to put a little flour. All right. Now, I work a lot with vinegars. I love vinegars. This one happens to be a coconut mango vinegar. Most people, when they eat tofu, think that the rule is it has to be Asian. And so we're not going to go Asian here. Because everybody does it with the Asian flavors, and that would be easy. So we're going to go non-Asian flavors here. I'm going to hit it. Do you smell it? Those of you up here back there, am I running back there with this for you in a second? I'll run. I know somebody. Green onion and parsley. Parsley, best seasoning in the world. It brings things to a level of freshness you can't imagine. It's like, oh my gosh, that's so good. And all you did was add parsley and green onion. It's what, 50 cents, 30 cents, a bunch of organic parsley? All right. We are going to add a little bit of the one that we call our dipshit, which is actually Southwestern, but it has lime juice and cumin, so we're going to go a little crazy with it. And then we're going to add coconut, almonds, and I'm going to give you the coup here, but I'm hiding it the whole time. I don't want you to see. Almonds, coconut, there's no recipe. You throw in whatever you want. You got pistachios? Throw in pistachios. I have a soapy towel, if you could wipe that or turn it over so we can... Little coconut, anybody hate coconut? You're not eating this. All right, and now this is how we're going to puelle it. This is just one I picked up, pineapple, mango, and coconut water, naked juice. You got juice in your fridge? Toss it in. What? Then you won't make this for him. Or if you want to upgrade to a different husband, make it all the time. You tell me what you want to do. I can't tell you what you want to do. If you love your husband, then probably make him something else. All right. So now all the flavors are in here. We've extracted nothing. And you have one spoon left, so how am I going to taste it? Make sure we're right on with the seasoning. Hang on. Cheers, folks. We're on it. Now, if I had my druthers and I was a person that liked hot stuff, I would put a little chili oil in this. There you go. There's our tofu. Puelle method. Everything on top of the stove, no recipe, a little this, a little that, totally following that method of cooking. Any questions so far? Yes? Uh-huh. Yeah, it'll caramelize. It'll caramelize a little. If it doesn't, tell me what you think you should do. We both know. Turn the broiler on. Put it under the broiler for a nanosecond or two. You guys all have it within you that, gee, it's not brown and I want it to be brown. Brown it. Put it up, put the broiler on. Yes? I just toss it in a bowl and in the oven. All right. Am I out of pan, sister girls? Well, I'm making chicken, so I'll use the chicken pan. We're back to the last chicken. We're good. Okay. We're going to do the coconut, or coconut. See what happens? We're going to do a quick balsamic chicken. Touch of Arbequina olive oil. Arbequina is the kind of olive. Use whatever you want. Vegetable oil, use butter if you want. I don't care. Use what you want. Don't let me tell you it doesn't have to be made with that oil. It can be made with any oil you want. And we have a canned tomato, diced tomato, organic, and it's a low sodium. I don't want something that's 900 milligrams of sodium because then I won't reach for my spice that you're going to put in because it'll be salty and then, it wouldn't work. Okay, We're going to cut a couple fresh tomatoes. And the reason we cut a couple fresh tomatoes is when I'm using canned tomatoes, I always enhance it because you fool people. They're like, oh. And if you use totally fresh tomatoes, they don't have time to concentrate. So then the dish is not rich enough. So I use some canned and some fresh. All right, we're going to grab one of those flattened chickens. Put it in the flour. Put it in the pan. What's the method again? Puele. No oven. Now, let's say you don't want any oil in it. Then start with just the chicken in the pan and brown it. It will brown. If the pan starts and it's hot, you don't have to have that olive oil. You know, they start out nonstick, but the first time you put it in the dishwasher, they're going to stick. So if you wash them by hand your whole life, you're good. We use a little of both at the restaurant. I use nonstick mostly for desserts that may have a high sugar content, like bread pudding, because that will stick just because the sugar loves the aluminum. Okay. We're going to cover this. I hear me. All right. Okay, yes. I'll tell you, like a store like Sprouts and everything is going to have a whole big section. The grocery store, ask them. I don't know. At like Ralph's and those kind of places, I've seen it by soy sauce. Other places, I've seen it in their health food section. Okay, we're going to turn this over. We're going to rush it a little. And then we're going to hit it with the tomato and the juice, because that's going to be what we puele with. Megan, you did a great job opening it, and I closed it. And a little bit of our chicken seasoning, which is an Italian chicken seasoning. It has roasted garlic, basil, fennel. I'm not trying to sell our seasonings here. You don't ever have to buy them and we'll still be fine. But it is good. They're in the vendor room. And you can go to our website. Okay. So now we have the tomatoes. And I'm going to hit it with a little parsley. If I had a basil plant, I'd hit it with basil, a little bit of green onion. And here's where it gets fun. We're going to do this between all of us. Which balsamic? Am I using peach, fig, or peach? Fig? We're going with fig balsamic. Vinegar has no carbs. Isn't that kind of fun? They make balsamic vinegar kind of like wine. A lot of times they age it, this brand, they age it in oak casks. It gets some of those tannins. It gets mellow. It's not pungent like distilled vinegar. All right, Chris, we're going to cut this up. I'm going to let that sauce reduce a little bit. Look how rich. But look how easy this stuff is. These are all things you could have in your house all the time. You can get, oh my gosh, there's a booth next to us, I think, in the room that has flavored balsamics. Yeah. Oh, man, they're so incredible. And it's an easy way to flavor something with a clean flavor that's quick. Sorry, I got to use my hands, folks. Okay, so it's hard to control when you're on the stovetop. Oh, my gosh, look, it's getting dry and the chicken's not quite done. So if it's getting dry, add water. Water's free. Well, not totally free, but it's not crazy expensive. Salt goes on the dining room table, not in cooking. It does go in baking. And why do you think? I'll tell you why. Because salt What did they do in the olden days on the in the butcher block on top of the wood table at the end of the day? Covered it with salt. It absorbed the moisture, and salt is hostile to bacteria. That's why you would take salted beef and that kind of thing on the wagon trail, because you're in the heat, and salt inhibits bacteria growth. Salt, when you cook with it, extracts moisture. So if you're trying to caramelize something and get the outside golden brown and the natural sugars, and you're bringing moisture, if I put water in, it's not going to caramelize. You can't get something crispy with water. I put water in after I've caramelized. So I put salt in at the end on the table in the dining room. All right, we're going to add just a touch more water. How was the chicken with the mango or the mango with the tofu? So if you don't want it to be sweet, don't use the mango juice. Guess what? Get the like the kale juice and use the kale juice at the end. These juices, all those incredible juices that are available in the market today, make incredible sauces as long as you don't use extended cooking. The rule of thumb is if you cook it more than 10 minutes, it's going to turn bitter. So when you add that juice, it's like add the juice off the heat. You don't want to boil it, reduce it, thicken it, let it be in there any length of time. All right, here we go. A little more fresh. Here's your chicken balsamico. Oh, you almost let me forget the fresh tomatoes at the end. Hang on. Hold on. I'll do this just for you guys because it's so wet. Whoop. Oh, well. I saw they had a really big carpet cleaner. They'll get their money's worth today. All right. Any questions? Our restaurant, our spices proverbially hit the fan, and that's all we do now. We don't have the restaurant. Our lease was up in the end of December, and we just do the spices. And in the spring, we're coming out with a new line of condiments. So, Food on Main, P-H-O-O-D in Riverside, yes. We used to be. But used to be's don't count anymore. They just lay on the floor till we sweep them away. There you go. Any other questions about food, about cooking, about the Puelle method? Okay, everybody, I want you to show me medium rare on your thermometer. Medium. Show me medium. Fingers together. Okay, middle finger. Hanging down, relaxed. If you have it up here and everything, you're not going to get a true reading. That's medium. If you buy one of those fork thermometers or you get one, give it to charity. And I'll tell you why. Now you have two exit wounds. When you put that fork in and all that juice comes out, you've extracted it. Now there's an exit wound for all that moisture that's in your food to exit. So you guys are pretty sharp and you know when something's done if you use this method. Any other questions? All righty. That's it? Yes. Do I season my meat before we cook it? Okay. Let's talk real quick about seasoning meat before cooking. Those of you that are leaving, goodbye. Okay, here's the deal. If you season your meat before you cook it, like a prime rib, and you're not turning it over, that's fine. But all those people who put something on a steak and turn it over and it falls in the grill, that company loves you because then you need to buy more to put on the other side. So a lot of times what we do in the restaurant industry, we do what we called on the turn. You season it on the turn. You turn the meat over, then you season it. There's enough residual heat over a 1,000-degree grill that it will get cooked and all the flavors will come out, but we don't put the seasoning on the side that goes against the grill because that will fall in and burn. So we season on the turn.